जनरल एनेस्थेटिक एजेंट्स। एंशिएंट टाइम वेरियस एजेंट्स लाइक ओपियोइड्स, अल्कोहल, कैनाबिस एंड हायोसिन वर बींग यूज अंटिल 19th सेंचुरी टू अमेलियोरेट पेन एसोसिएटेड विद सर्जरीज। सर्टेन नॉन ड्रग मेथड्स लाइक एस्फिक्सिया, फ्रीजिंग, कॉन्कशन एंड ब्लो ऑन हेड वर ऑल्सो बींग यूज। The quick induction of anesthesia and safe and reversible consciousness for any desired duration begin in 1840s with the introduction of nitrous oxide. And with the picture here, you can also see that after nitrous oxide, there were development of many more inhalational agents discovered as anesthetic agents. After N2O, it was ether, then chloroform, and after the discovery of halothane, which is a halogenated inhalational anesthetic agent, there were development of many more inhalational anesthetic agents are there, which are non-inflammable and non-irritant. And before the discovery of halothane, almost all the agents were inflammable in characteristic, except nitrous oxide. Now, before the introduction of anesthetic agents, we should note certain terms like what is anesthesia. It's a reversible condition of comfort, quiescence and physiological stability in a patient before, during and after performance of a procedure. What's a general anesthesia? For surgical procedure to render the patient unaware or unresponsive to the painful stimuli with loss of consciousness is known as general anesthesia, and drugs producing general anesthesia are called as general anesthetics. There are certain cardinal features to be considered a drug as general anesthesia, that it should provide analgesia, it should provide amnesia, that means loss of memory. There should be loss of all the sensations like pain sensation, touch, temperature, proprioception sensation. There should be loss of all the reflexes, like if the incision is being given on the skin or on the peritoneum, there should be no reflex movement, and there should be loss of consciousness. So the patient should not be having any awareness of an ongoing procedure. There should be a good muscle relaxant effect of an anesthetic agent, so the person become immobile during the procedure. Properties of an ideal anesthetic for the patient: it should be pleasant, it should be non-irritating, it should not cause any post-op nausea and vomiting, and the induction and recovery should be very fast with no after effect in the patient. And for surgeon, an ideal anesthetic should provide adequate analgesia, it should provide immobility and muscle relaxation, and it should be non-inflammable and non-explosive so that cautery can be used during the procedure to stop the bleeders. And for anesthetic, an ideal anesthetic agent should be administered very easily and it should be controllable. Margin of safety should be wide, that means no effect on vitals like blood pressure, respiration and cardiac activities. There should be rapid adjustment in the depth of anesthesia, and it should not react with rubber tubings or soda lime, as most of the inhalational agents are used in a closed circuit having soda lime and some rubber tubings. Let's move on to the stages of anesthesia. There are four stages of anesthesia, from loss of pain sensation in the stage 1 to combative behavior or excitement in the stage 2. Third stage is the stage of surgical anesthesia, and the fourth stage is of medullary paralysis at the highest dose of anesthesia. If we see the parameters which are used to assess the depth of the anesthesia are the pupil size, that means there should be midriasis. There should be no ocular movements which are considered that the anesthesia is not appropriate. There should be no reflexes, and respiration depth should be monitored in case of anesthesia, and the tone of the muscles are being checked to see the depth of the anesthesia. So Gudels divide the stages of anesthesia into four stages. It is being seen when he used ether as an anesthetic agent, because ether is a slow anesthetic agent, so all the stages are quite visible with the ether. So stage 1 is the stage of analgesia, and almost all the parameters remain normal, like respiration is normal, ocular movements are there, pupil size is normal, and all the reflexes are present, but patient does not sense pain. So this is the stage of analgesia, and this is the stage in which labor can be performed. Only labor can be performed at this stage of anesthesia. As the dose of the anesthesia is increased, stage 2 is achieved, which is a stage of excitement in which respiration becomes irregular, the blood pressure starts falling, the pupil size is increased, and eye reflexes are present, but they are very less. So this is a very unpleasant stage to the patient. Patient become restless in this stage. And during this stage, the patient usually struggle, and duration of this stage is more with ether and less with the halothane, and absent with the IV anesthetic agents. And the difficulty occur because of laryngospasm in this stage. And with the IV anesthetic agent, stage 1 and 2 are not visible, as patient directly enters in the stage 3. So what is stage 3? Stage 3 is divided further into 4 planes. In plane 1, the respiration become normal here, and the pupil start decreasing in its size. The plane 1 is considered is of roving eyeball movements. In plane 1, there is loss of cutaneous reflex, but peritoneal reflexes are present in plane 1. So when we increases the dose of anesthesia, plane 2 is achieved, where there is a respiration starts decreasing, but still respiration is regular here, but there is no eye motion, and pupil size is lesser than the normal pupil size, and there is loss of all reflexes. Here is not only cutaneous, but also the peritoneal and deep reflexes are absent in this plane. So this is the plane. That means stage 3, plane 2 is the stage of surgical anesthesia actually, which is required to perform any surgery. As the dose of the anesthesia is increased, plane 3 is achieved, in which pupil again starts dilating, and there is loss of pupillary light reflex, but not complete loss of light reflex, and there is no response to the skin incision in this stage. Again, as the dose increased, the plane 4 is achieved, in which pupil dilated to more size, and there is complete absence of light reflex. Like if the patient will not respond to the light, the pupil will not respond to the light. So there is total absence of light reflex, and the respiration become abdominal in plane 4 of the stage 3. Then achieve stage 4, which is imminent death. It is the highest dose of anesthesia when given. Total apnea occur, the pupil is completely dilated, and there is medullary paralysis, and the patient will go ultimately into coma or death. Let us see on what principle the anesthetic agents work. It is when the anesthesia is start administering, the induction phase is there, which is the onset of anesthesia, till the achievement of surgical anesthesia, that is stage 3 and plane 2. This induction should be fast and smooth. It should avoid stage 2, which is the dangerous excitatory phase or stage of delirium in which patient struggles. It should avoid stage 2. There should be no stage 2. Hypophilicity is the key factor for fast induction, and that's why IV fast inducing agents are used for induction of anesthesia. Then there is a maintenance phase, which is from surgical anesthesia achievement to when we stop the anesthesia. So this is the sustained stage of surgical anesthesia, and in this, inhalational agents are being used for maintenance of anesthesia. And from stoppage of anesthetic agent to full recovery of the patient, this is the stage of recovery. And recovery occur by redistribution in case of IV agents, and via exhalation of anesthetic agent in inhalational anesthetic agents. Let's see the classification of anesthetic agents. So general anesthetics are divided into two major classes, inhalational agents and intravenous agents. Inhalational agents In this, we have the gaseous agent in the form of nitrous oxide and certain halogenated liquids, which are given in aerosolized form via cylinders. And these are halothane, methoxyfluorine, anfluorine, isoflurane, sevoflurane, and dasfluorine. In intravenous agents, we have fast inducers, which induces very fast. So they are used for induction. These are barbiturates, thiopentone, and methohexital. Thiopental or thiopentone sodium, we can call it as. And there are certain non-barbiturates like propofol and etomidate. So these are fast inducers. Then also there are slow inducers, which are benzodiazepines like diazepam, lorazepam, midazolam. These are the three important benzodiazepines which can be used as anesthetic agents also. And there is one more newer drug, that is remimazolam, is under trial for anesthetic agent. And there is dissociative anesthetic agent, which is ketamine, can also be used as anesthetic agent. Let's see the molecular mechanism of general anesthesia. So basically, general anesthetic agents facilitate the inhibitory neurotransmitters. These are GABA neurotransmitter and glycine neurotransmitter. So they facilitate the inhibitory neurotransmitters. But ketamine, nitrous oxide, and xenon, they do not act through GABA or glycine, but they inhibit the NMDA receptors on which the excitatory neurotransmitter, that is the glutamate, acts, and the same mechanism causes unconsciousness with ketamine, nitrous oxide, and xenon. So glutamate or excitatory neurotransmitters are being inhibited, and the inhibitory neurotransmitters are being facilitated by these general anesthetic agents. So the main target of anesthetics is brain. Actually, it acts on cortex, hippocampus, thalamus, and brainstem, in which the reticular formation system, which is responsible for alertness and wakefulness, are the important site of action of general anesthetic agents. So, if we see the pathway of inhalational agents, drug is being inspired via the mechanism, and it reaches the alveoli. From alveoli to pulmonary capillaries, it reaches the systemic circulation via arterial blood. It reaches the brain and also in other tissues also. And from brain, after induction, the blood take up the anesthetic agent, and via venous blood it again reaches the alveoli, and exhalation occur and the recovery of the patient is there. So this is the pathway of inhalational anesthetic agents. So if we see the inhalational agents, the advantage is there that it can easily control the depth of the anesthesia is there with the inhalational agents, and metabolism is very minimal, but halogenated compounds, they get metabolized by liver. So hepatotoxicity and excretion is via kidney. So nephrotoxicity can be there with halogenated compounds. All the inhalational agents are described in terms of induction, recovery, boiling point, irritability, inflammability, and explosiveness, sensitization of heart to catecholamines, analgesia, muscle relaxation, reaction to soda lime, and organ damage. So if you want to study the individual inhalational agents, you should study them on the basis of these terms of their characteristics. There are certain important characteristics of inhalational agents which govern the anesthetic property. These are MAC value, that is minimum alveolar concentration, partial pressure of anesthetic in inspired gas, rate of pulmonary ventilation, alveolar exchange, oil-water partition quotient, blood-gas partition quotient, and oil-gas partition quotient. Let's understand them one by one. What is MAC value? It is the minimum alveolar anesthetic concentration which is required for 50% of patients to make them immobile. That means 50% of patients should not respond to a surgical stimulus. This is the minimum alveolar concentration of an anesthetic agent. It is a measure of inhalational anesthetic potency, efficacy, and depth of anesthesia. That means the minimum concentration of anesthetic agent which is present in the alveoli, which is responsible to make 50% of the patient immobile. So the minimum concentration, that means the higher the potency. The maximum the concentration, that means lower the potency. So if we have 100 patients, so out of 100 patients, if 50% of the patient become immobile at a particular concentration, this will be considered as MAC 50. MAC value are additive and lower in the presence of opioids. That means if two anesthetic drugs or an anesthetic drug is given along with an opioid agent, then MAC value decreases. That means potency of that inhalational agent will be increased. Lower the MAC value, higher will be the potency. MAC value of 1 is considered as adequate for surgery, but MAC value of 1.1 to 1.2 usually considered for most of the surgeries, because lower values than 1 also reduces the efficacy of values. So there are certain values of MAC. We can see here, if MAC value is 0.3, that means mild analgesia will be provided by the anesthetic agent. If 0.5, that means amnesia. 1 means 50% patients are immobile after noxious stimuli. MAC value 1.3 mean it will reduce the sympathetic response to surgery, and 99% of the subjects are immobile with MAC value of 1.3. And MAC value 2 mean it is fatal and total inhibition of electrical activity in the brain. So higher dose, MAC value of 2 means higher dose is there, which is not required, and it will cause the toxicity only. So more than value, more than 1.3 are rarely used in case of surgeries. Let's see what is oil gas partition coefficient or quotient. So we will consider it that if increase oil gas partition quotient is there. Increase oil gas means more solubility in oil or more solubility in lipid. That means drug is more lipid soluble. So it will be more soluble in the tissue, or it will be more fat soluble. So the tissue will store the drug and it will act as a reservoir. So the drug will not leave the tissue if it is present in the body or if it is present in the brain. Drug will not leave the tissue. Inhalational agent will not leave the tissue. So it will not come out of the tissue when recovery will be there. So elimination of a drug is less and slow recovery will be there with higher oil gas partition quotient. So higher the oil gas partition quotient, slower will be the recovery. We can understand this via this graph. You can see here on x-axis there is oil gas partition coefficient, while on y-axis there is MAC value. So we will take two examples of nitrous oxide and halothane. Nitrous oxide has higher MAC value. That means it has lower potency. Higher concentration is required to provide a particular depth of anesthesia. But also it has a lower oil gas partition quotient. That means lower fat solubility. That means lower lipid solubility. That means it will leave the tissue very easily. Hence recovery will be fast in case of nitrous oxide. But if we take example of halothane, it has lesser MAC value. That means it has higher potency, lower concentration will be required to provide a desired effect, but it has higher oil gas partition coefficient. That means it has higher fat solubility, it will not leave the tissue, and the recovery will be slow in case of halothane. As the oil gas partition coefficient increases, the MAC value decreases, you can see. Let's see the blood gas partition coefficient. That means if increased blood gas partition coefficient is there, means the blood will be more soluble in blood because the partition coefficient is higher. So there is more blood solubility of a drug. That means more drug will be required to saturate the blood. The drug will remain in the blood. More solubility in the blood means the drug will remain in the blood. It will not leave the blood. So from alveoli to blood, when the drug will travel, it will take time to saturate the blood on the higher side. So it will take time to saturate the blood, as well as when it reaches the brain, again the drug will not leave the blood to reaches the brain. So the drug will remain in the blood, and blood act as reservoir. Neither it will leave the blood from blood to brain side, neither it will leave the blood from blood to alveolar side. Hence, the induction will be slow, hence the recovery will be slow. And there is slow adjustment of depth of anesthesia as blood will act as reservoir of the drug. So, increased blood gas coefficient means more drug is there in the blood. More solubility of drug is there in the blood, and drug is not going to leave the blood on either side, neither on the recovery side, neither on the induction side. Hence, increased blood gas partition coefficient means the drug will have slow recovery and slow induction. And nitrous oxide is almost insoluble in the blood, hence fast recovery and fast induction. You can also understand blood gas partition coefficient by this picture. You can see here the nitrous oxide has the lesser blood gas partition coefficient, hence it achieves the equilibrium very fast. That means from alveoli to blood and from blood to brain, it achieves very fast this whole pathway, hence recovery as well as induction both achieve very fast. So fast induction as well as fast recovery. But halothane has a lesser blood gas partition quotient, so it take time to saturate the blood, it take time to equilibrate, it take time for induction as well as a recovery. So more blood gas partition coefficient is there with halothane, hence slower induction and slower recovery. You can also understand it by this diagram also. For a particular time period, you can see here with the nitrous oxide, the concentration of nitrous oxide in the airway, the concentration almost similar is there in the alveoli, almost similar in the blood and in the brain. So the equilibrium which is achieving, that is very fast with nitrous oxide with the particular time period. But you can see here with the halothane, the equilibrium which has been achieved at that particular time is very low. The concentration differs so much in the airway to the brain. Hence, halothane is considered as a slow induction and slow recovery drug. There is an important event associated with the inhalational agent, specifically nitrous oxide, and that is second gas effect. So nitrous oxide is very insoluble in the blood and other tissues. So it has low blood gas quotient, and this results in rapid equilibrium achievement. The rapid uptake of nitrous oxide from alveolar gas serves to concentrate co-administered halogenated anesthetic agents, which are considered as second gas. And this effect is the second gas effect, which speeds the induction of anesthesia. How does it occur? We can understand it by this example. So you can see here, then in inspired gas, the alveoli, in the alveoli, the nitrous oxide is present in 70% concentration, the oxygen is in 29%, and the isoflurane is 1%. Nitrous oxide uptake is very fast because it is insoluble in the blood, so it achieves equilibrium very fast. So nitrous oxide will be uptaken very fast. Here the concentration of nitrous oxide in the alveoli will be reduced from 70% to 54%, and remaining void of alveoli will be filled with the tracheal inspiration that will increase the concentration of oxygen as well as isoflurane in the alveoli. Along with that, nitrous oxide will also be inspired, so hence the concentration occur with the oxygen is 39%, nitrous oxide 60%, and isoflurane is 1.3%. So you can see here from 1% to 1.3%, the concentration of isoflurane or halogenated anesthetic agent has been increased, and this is known as the concentration effect. And as if you will see, the total molecule of gas or the size of the alveoli has also been increased, because total number of molecules of the gas has been increased with the uptake of nitrous oxide from first to last. You can see here, so this is known as second gas effect. Nitrous oxide increases the concentration of second gas along with this. We can also understand it by this example. Like if we consider that There in the alveoli, the two molecules of halothane are present, 18 molecules of oxygen, 80 molecules of nitrous oxide. So total 100 molecule of the combination of gases are present in alveoli. As soon as the nitrous oxide will be taken up by the blood, which is very fast, considered very fast. So if we consider that 50% of nitrous oxide is being taken up by the blood, that means 40 molecules of nitrous oxide will leave the alveoli, hence the halothane molecule remain 2, oxygen 18 and nitrous oxide will remain 40 molecules. So here 60 molecules are remained in the alveoli and rest 40 molecules of nitrous oxide are being taken up by the blood. So the movement of gas from trachea to fill the void will occur, and it will fill the remaining of the alveoli in the form that half of the previous level of the molecules will be inhaled this time. So out of 2, only 1 molecule of halothane and 9 molecule of oxygen and 40 molecule of nitrous oxide will be inhaled this time from trachea to alveoli. So total molecules this time here are 110. So this is that it has induced the inhalation also. The uptake of nitrous oxide not only increased the concentration of halothane, like you can see here from 2 molecules the concentration of halothane here has become 3. And the total molecule were 100, from 100 to it has become 110. So not only concentration of halothane has increased, but also the induction of inhalation has also been increased here. Again, if you see in the concentration form, previously from out of 100 molecule, only 2 molecules of halothane, that means 2% of the halothane were there, and the nitrous oxide concentration were 80%. From here, it has been increased when the nitrous oxide uptake has been occur. So the concentration of halothane is increased from 2 to 3.4%. As out of 60 molecules, there were 2 molecules of halothane, and out of 60 molecules, there were 40 molecules of nitrous oxide were there. So the concentration has been increased from 2 to 3.4% with halothane, but it has been reduced from 80 to 67% with the nitrous oxide. At last, when the alveoli is being filled, the concentration reduces, but still it is more than the previous concentration, like from 2 to 2.7% again increased with the halothane, and it is reduced with the nitrous oxide from 80 to 72%. So we can see here as a concentration effect of drug was there, and as an increased tracheal inflow was occur, if a drug is being given along with nitrous oxide, as nitrous oxide alone cannot act because it is a very low efficacy drug, so alone it will not act as a good anesthetic agent. So we need to give another drug, but another drug alone cannot be given as the drug is having having very high solubility in blood. So induction is very low with the halothane. So we need to give both the drugs along with, and nitrous oxide act as a carrier for halothane or other inhalational agent. As nitrous oxide fasten up the concentration of the halothane as well as increase the tracheal flow. So this is the second gas effect. Nitrous oxide was the first gas, which increases the concentration as well as inflow of the second gas. So this is second gas effect. Another one important property of inhalational agent, specifically nitrous oxide, is diffusional hypoxia. Like on discontinuation of nitrous oxide administration, nitrous oxide gas can diffuse from blood to the alveoli and dilute the concentration of oxygen in the lung. Because it is used in higher concentration, so higher number of molecules of oxygen will be displaced. As the nitrous oxide having lower solubility in the blood, so it will leave the blood very fast and it will fill the alveoli very fast, and the molecules of the oxygen will be replaced from the alveoli. Hence, the effect will be in the form of hypoxia will be there. So because it is the because of diffusion of nitrous oxide from blood to alveoli, it is called as diffusional hypoxia. And to avoid diffusional hypoxia, 100% of oxygen should be administered at last time period, that means in last minutes when nitrous oxide is discontinued. Now, inhalational agents, the nitrous oxide one is the important. It is safest inhalational anesthetic agent, which is non-inflammable, non-irritating. It is low potency anesthetic agent, so it cannot be used alone. It has poor muscle relaxant, but it is a very good analgesic. And no toxic effect on the heart, liver and kidney, that's why it is very safe. But adverse effect is in the form of diffusional hypoxia, which we have already discussed. And it cannot be used alone as it has low potency and low efficacy. That's why alone it cannot be used. Along with that, nitrous oxide should not be used with vitamin B12 deficiency anemia, as it is degraded by interaction with vitamin B12. So if vitamin B12 will be less, there can be chances of nitrous oxide toxicity. Now if we see the comparison of all the inhalational agents, in the form of the terms, we have already discussed that inhalational agent should be studied in all these parameters terms. So if we see the irritancy level of the inhalational agents, almost all are unpleasant, but sevoflurane is quite pleasant to the airways. If we see analgesic property, nitrous oxide is the most potent analgesic, rest doesn't possess any analgesic property. Muscle relaxation is good with isoflurane and anflurane, while rest of the inhalational agents does not possess muscle relaxation. If we see the dilation of bronchioles that occur with halothane and sevoflurane, that's why they can be used with asthmatic agents. If we see the MAC value, it is maximum with nitrous oxide and it is minimum with halothane. Hence, the higher the MAC value, lower will be the potency, and lower the MAC value, higher will be the potency. Hence, halothane has the maximum potency, so it will be used in the lowest concentration. It will be required in lowest concentration to produce a desired effect. If you see the blood gas partition quotient, it is lesser with the nitrous oxide. That's why it will achieve the equilibrium very fast, so fastest induction is there with the nitrous oxide and lowest with the halothane. If you see about the pressures, almost all the pressures are reduced with inhalational agents, in contrary to IV agents, which increases almost all the pressures except the blood pressure. With the IV agents, almost all the pressures are increased, including the intracranial pressure, intraocular pressure. If you see certain special features, the nitrous oxide, we have already read that it is responsible for diffusion hypoxia, and it is used as a carrier or adjuvant with for the other inhalational agents, specifically the halogenated inhalational drugs, and it is the cheapest one. If you see the halothane, it sensitizes the heart for arrhythmogenic potential of adrenaline, so it should be given very consciously in the patients having increased level of sympathetic activity. It reduces the respiratory rate, or it is respiratory depressant, and also it decreases the uterine contractions. As it is metabolized with the liver, it can be a hepatotoxicity will be there with halothane, and it is responsible for malignant hyperthermia as a side effect. It can be responsible for post-operative shivering, which can be treated by giving pathidine, and halothane can be preferred in asthmatic as an anesthetic agent. If you see the isoflurane, it is 1.5 times more potent than sevoflurane. Unlike halothane, it is safe in myocardial infarction, and but more respiratory depression is there with isoflurane, but there is better adjustment of depth of anesthesia and low toxicity potential. And it does not provoke seizures, so it can be preferred for the patients undergoing neurosurgery. But dasfluran is a good alternative to isoflurane for neurosurgery. Anfluran can provoke seizures, so it should not be used in patients undergoing neurosurgery. And Sevoflurane, unlike desflurane, poses no problem in induction and it is preferred anesthetic agent for induction in children, asthmatics, as well as myocardial infarction. Although the inhalation agents usually does not used for induction, but sevoflurane can be used in children and asthmatic patients. But its high cost and need for high flow open system makes it very expensive to use. So it is not used much in developing countries, as it is degraded by soda lime and not recommended for use in closed circuits. So open circuits are required if sevoflurane is being used. So if we see the important one, that nitrous oxide is very cheap and safest inhalational agent. Halothane sensitizes heart to adrenergic potential of adrenaline and it can lead to malignant hypothermia. Isoflurane is preferred for neurosurgery and flurane provokes seizures, so it should not be given in patients having any central nervous system disorders. And sevoflurane is preferred in children and it is used in high flow open system, and closed circuit is not used for sevoflurane. Now moving on to parenteral anesthetic agents, and these are used for induction of anesthesia and rapid onset of action is there with IV agents. Recovery is mainly by redistribution, and it also reduce the amount of inhalational anesthetic agents which is required for maintenance. And the examples we have already read, these are thiopental or thiopental sodium or midazolam, propofol, etomidate and ketamine. Now let's see the individual parenteral agents. Thiopentone sodium, its t-half is 9 hours and it has high lipid solubility, and because of high lipid solubility it is ultra short acting with the duration of 5 to 10 minutes. And the reason behind the ultra short action is its redistribution, and because of redistribution there is a rapid recovery from anesthesia and consciousness is regained in 10 to 20 minutes. Now you can see here that if T-half is 9 hours, then why the effect vanishes in within 5 to 10 minutes? So reason behind that is redistribution. Because of ultra short action, the rapid induction is also there, that within 20 seconds in one arm brain circulation. That means when we give thiopentone sodium in the arm, as a intravenous agent, so from arm it reaches towards heart and from heart to brain, so this is one arm circulation. As soon as it reaches the brain, it shows its effect and then it is redistributed towards the other parts of body and other tissues, and because of its high solubility it stays there. So the effect come as anesthetic agents very fast. Instead of the T-half of 9 hours, the duration is of 5 to 10 minutes. And if you want to increase the effect of anesthesia, then it should be given with the continuous infusion. Again, the complete recovery takes time of more than 9 hours, that is more than its T-half, because it has high lipid solubility. So the tissue will not leave the drug immediately, hence complete recovery takes time. Although the patient has come out of anesthetic effect, but the recovery takes time, complete recovery takes time of more than T-half, and it also produces hangover because of this effect. It does not possess analgesia. So unlike the inhalational agents which possess good analgesia, specifically the nitrous oxide, all the IV agents does not possess the analgesic or the muscle relaxant effect. But the inhalational agents are good analgesics as well as good muscle relaxants. So the thiopentone sodium requires nitrous oxide and fentanyl along with pain killers. No muscle relaxation is there, hence it's required the short acting succinylcholine as a muscle relaxant for short procedures, because thiopentone sodium itself is ultra short acting inducing agents. So if you will give along with a good muscle relaxant, so for short procedures the thiopentone sodium can be used as anesthetic agents, for example intubation, bronchoscopy, endoscopy. But the thing which need to be remembered is it should not be mixed in the same syringe because it reacts chemically. So thiopentone sodium should be given separate and the succinylcholine should be given separate injections, and they should not be mixed in the same syringe. In consciousness is there, and resistance to mold or telling lie of the subject is lost when the thiopentone sodium is giving, and this property is used as a truth serum. And but if what are the answers are being given by the patient should not be considered as relevant all the time. It increases all the pressures except blood pressure. So unlike inhalational agents, which reduces almost all the pressures, the IV agents increases all the pressures, but blood pressure is not increased by thiopentone sodium. So it increases intraocular pressure, hence it is contraindicated in eye injury. It increases intracranial pressure, hence the thiopentone sodium is contraindicated in trauma, hyperkalemia and crush injury. But as it reduces the blood pressure, so it should be contraindicated in shock or patient having hypotension. What occur with extravasation? So if the drug leaks out of the injection site, it may cause pain, necrosis of the tissues, and gangrene can also occur. And the pain can be reduced with the giving lignocaine along with the thiopentone sodium. It also possesses potent anticonvulsant property. So it is used in status epilepticus where other drugs does not act or fail to act. Now let's see the propofol. The patient feel better than giving thiopentone because it has a rapid induction because of high lipid solubility and preparation is oily. It has rapid recovery, tenfold faster than the thiopentone sodium due to faster metabolism, and it can also used as day care anesthesia. That means on the same day the surgery has been performed on the patient, and because of faster recovery, patient may go home. So this is the day care anesthesia. On the same day, patient can be relieved from the ward. It is non-irritant to airways, so can be used for maintenance also. So no need to give separate for induction and as well as maintenance. Propofol itself can act as inducing agent as well as for maintenance agent. So this one property is also helpful to make it as a daycare anesthesia. It also possesses anti-emetic property, so no post-op nausea vomiting is there to the patient. It is safe in pregnancy as well, although it crosses the placenta, but still it is safe in pregnancy. There are certain disadvantages, like it releases histamine, so it may lead to anaphylactoid reaction. It also leads to respiratory depression as well as hypotension, just like thiopentone sodium. There is a pain at injection site after giving propofol, and there is propofol infusion syndrome when it is given with the higher rate of infusion, and if it is given for prolonged time period, so there can be propofol infusion syndrome will be there. Phosphopropofol is a drug which is water soluble alternative to propofol, and it does not cause hypotension or respiratory depression, so it can be a good alternative to propofol. And altanolone is a painless injectable IV anesthetic agent having less cardiovascular side effect as well as no respiratory depression. So these two are the newer drugs can be used alternative to propofol. Let's see the benzodiazepines. These are slower acting, used for maintenance of anesthesia and used for short procedures like cardiac catheterization, angiographies, electroconvulsive therapy, close reduction of fractures and endoscopies. It produces sedation, amnesia and unconsciousness within 5 to 10 minutes, and consciousness is regained within 1 hour. It do not depresses respiration, myocardium or blood pressure, and action is reversed by flumazenil. So if overdose occur, in that case antidote flumazenil is available there. Midazolam is a good benzodiazepine anesthetic agent which is used commonly because there is no thrombophlebitis unlike diazepam, and it is used to produce sedation and amnesia without analgesia in short procedures which does not require pain relief, like endoscopies, bronchoscopy, cardiac catheterization, patient on ventilators, pre-anesthetic medication, adjuvant to general anesthetic agents, status epilepticus type of conditions where midazolam can be used. Ketamine is another one important drug among IV anesthetic agents. It is known as dissociative anesthesia. Dissociative anesthesia is because it dissociates the person from surrounding as well as from own body. Its characteristic features are that it is a profound possess profound analgesia, immobility, amnesia with light sleep, and but poor muscle relaxation. So as we have seen that IV anesthetic agents are not good analgesic, but ketamine is a good analgesic agent, so it does not require any analgesic along with it, but it increases sympathetic stimulation or increases sympathetic activity. Hence it is a potent bronchodilator and suitable for asthmatics. It is useful for patient with circulatory volume loss, that is, as it increases blood pressure. And like other IV agents which reduces blood pressure, but because of sympathetic stimulation it increases blood pressure. Hence this anesthetic agent can be used in patients having circulatory volume loss like dehydration, vomiting, hemorrhage, shock, anemia. And it is also suitable for low general condition patients like geriatric patient or in children also. This is a very good anesthetic agent, can be used in children, geriatric population and patient having low general condition. There are certain disadvantages that it increases all the pressures including blood pressure. It is a derivative of phencyclidine. So it's a hallucinogen, that's why emergence delirium, hallucinations and involuntary movements occur during recovery, which can be minimized by giving diazepam or midazolam to the patients. And this point is to be remembered that it is used in most of the MCQs. There are contraindications like hypertension, myocardial infarction and increased intracranial tension as it increases all the pressures. There's a term called balanced anesthesia. More than two drugs when are given along with like a multi-drug approach is used to manage the patient's needs. Balanced anesthesia takes advantage of drugs' beneficial effects while minimizing each agent's adverse qualities. Like when more drugs are given along with, their dose will be reduced, hence their side effect will be reduced, but the beneficial effects are add-on to the combination. It is achieved by inhaled anesthesia given along with the IV anesthetic agents and pre-anesthetic medications. Then what are these pre-anesthetic medication? That means it is used, the use of drugs prior to anesthesia to make it more safe and pleasant. That is to relieve anxiety of the patient by giving benzodiazepines, because if it will reduce the anxiety, the dose of the drugs will also get reduced. To prevent allergic reaction, antihistamines are being given. To prevent nausea and vomiting, antiemetics. And to provide analgesia, opioids. To prevent acidity, proton pump inhibitors. And to prevent bradycardia and secretions, atropine, glycopyrrolate and hyoscine type of pre-anesthetic medications are given prior to general anesthesia. There's a term neuroleptic analgesia, that means which is characterized by calmness, psychic indifference and intense analgesia without total loss of consciousness. It is the combination of fentanyl and droperidol. So neuroleptic agent here is droperidol. It is an antipsychotic and analgesic here is fentanyl. But adverse effect in the form of chest wall rigidity because of fentanyl, slow recovery, respiratory depression because of fentanyl, which is an opioid analgesic, and extrapyramidal side effect because of droperidol, which is an antipsychotic, may occur. There is a term neuroleptic anesthesia also there if we include nitrous oxide and auxin along with droperidol and fentanyl, then this will become a neuroleptic anesthesia. Thank you.